Your Steve Jones Show podcast is loading now. The Steve Jones Show podcast is sponsored by Sunbury Motors, North 4th Street in Sunbury, and Sunbury Motors Kia, routes 11 and 15 in Hummel's Wharf. Sports talk where your voice counts. This is the Steve Jones Show on News Radio 1070 WKOK. Now from the Sunbury Motors Studio, here's Steve Jones.
Good afternoon, everybody. It is the Steve Jones Show on a hump day already on the short holiday week. Matt Catrillo here with you. Steve will soon be there from the Sunbury Motors Studio. Sunbury Motors, 4th Street in Sunbury. Sunbury Motors Kia, routes 11 and 15 in Hummel's Wharf, and online at sunburymotors.com. Ford, Kia, Hyundai, a great selection of pre-owned inventory, and a great service department that is there for your current vehicle with the diagnostics, with the inspections, with the routine maintenance like the oil change, and a sales staff that is there for you and not just there for the sale to make sure you have a good deal that is right for you. All part of the Sunbury Motors guarantee to save you money. All at Sunbury Motors, 4th Street in Sunbury. Sunbury Motors Kia, routes 11 and 15 in Hummel's Wharf, online at sunburymotors.com. We've got a very, very interesting show today. Tony Knott from Ticket Manager is back with us, and he's kind of seen this coming a little bit as far as USC and UCLA's move, especially from USC's end where he's based in LA, moving to the Big Ten. We'll get all of his reaction and the latest analysis on everything, all the moving parts in college football coming up. BTN's Mike DeSorcy is also in with us, and you never know what you're going to hear from him either as far as his opinions on especially everything happening right now in college football. And we got Aeneas Hawkins joining us today. Recap Lift for Life and preview the upcoming season for Penn State football. Looking forward to having him joining us too. So that's what's coming up on the docket for today. We got a lot more guests coming up this week too, so it's been a busy week with a lot happening around what's going on in college football. We'll get to more of that in a sec as we set the table for today. But first, this just came in a little while ago. The Browns have indeed traded Baker Mayfield. They have traded him to Carolina for a conditional draft pick. It'll be a fourth or fifth round pick depending on his playing time. So looking at this from the Browns' perspective, just really quickly here, it's interesting they make this move now. It's not, you know, there was obviously the tension between the two sides ever since the Deshaun Watson thing. Plus, he was already unsure about his future. On top of it, Baker Mayfield had acknowledged that both sides were moving on. So, in that aspect, it's not that surprising. But you still do not know about Deshaun Watson. And, of course, the reports are out there that the NFL is still looking for a lengthy suspension, like a year or more, as that discipline case went on late last week. We still haven't gotten word on what the suspension's going to be yet. So you're down to just Jacoby Brissett, who's been a veteran quarterback who's been able to make his name somewhat in the NFL and step in. But you leave that risk even more now, depending on what happens with Deshaun Watson. And the Panthers side of things, I don't know what you do with quarterback. You got Matt Corral, you got that you just drafted, you got Sam Darnold that's been down there, not really doing a whole lot. To me, I think you got to see what you have in your young quarterback if you're Carolina, and you move on from Sam Darnold, and maybe you give Baker Mayfield a shot at this point. I mean, that's what's telling me about that move. So we'll see how that plays out. But now we get to the latest on what's been happening in college football. So to catch up, CBS Sports' Dennis Dodd reported About 9 o'clock last night, the ACC and the Pac-12 are now discussing, quote, here we go again, a loose partnership that could include a championship game in Las Vegas. Now, I guess that's not totally surprising because you remember from the dumb alliance last year, there was the Big Ten, the ACC, and the Pac-12. So the fact that those two conferences have chatted about that isn't all that surprising. But if I'm the ACC, I don't want any part of this with the Pac-12. Who would at this point with the way things are? I mean, because they're kind of like in the middle tier right now. And again, right now it's survival of the fittest. So I'm just not quite sure how that would work out for the ACC. And now you got the Big 12. This comes after what we talked about yesterday with the Big 12 and the Pac-12 going back and forth trying to poach each other. This is just musical chairs, and it's just comedy at this point.
First of all, I refer to this as the silly season.
Right? Yes, and exactly
I referred to it as the silly season a year ago, and nothing has changed. This is where everybody either writes columns or does talk shows, and they start speculating left and right. Just slow down. It's okay. If I'm the SEC, I'm looking around, and I'm Greg Sankey, I like what I have. If I'm Kevin Warren, I'm looking around, and guess what? I like what I have. If Notre Dame wants to make a move, Notre Dame makes a move. Okay? And then at that point, we'll see what move, if any, they wanted to make. They may not want to make any move. They may sit there and they're content with their, and then negotiate a new deal with NBC, which is not even remotely in the same ballpark as the Big Ten deal. I mean, Notre Dame's deal is about 20 to 25 million a year. It's not, but it's still a good deal. For Notre Dame, it's just, you know, it's not in the ballpark, though, what the Big Ten gets, and it's not in the ballpark of what the SEC gets. It just isn't. But that's, to me, you can afford now to play the waiting game. You can afford to do that. You don't have to be aggressive about anything. You already, you know, if you're the SEC, you already hit the two home runs you needed to. You got Texas and Oklahoma. If you're the Big Ten, you already hit the two home runs you needed. You got USC and UCLA. We're going to have Tony Knopp on to talk about all that in the final half hour of the show today. This will be on the first and the next half hour. And then Mike DeCourcy will be on at 4:06 today. So that's how it's going to work. Tony is a vast wealth of information on what has happened here. Mike is a great wealth of information. But we'll have Hawk on next half hour, and then Mike, and then we'll close out with Tony today. And tomorrow, Mark Fowler is going to join us from the Arizona Republic. Mark and I went to school together here at Penn State, friends when we were here. It turns out the last 20 years after, you know, he's made various stops along the way. The last 20 years, though, he's been at the Arizona Republic covering Arizona State, Arizona. And he will give us that perspective as to what next. Because the only ones that really are in the category of, oh, we got to see what happens now, is not the Big Ten or the SEC. No, you have it backwards. And I'll go back to what I said a year ago about when Texas and Oklahoma went. I said, look, the problem does. I said, it's what the Big 12 does. What happens with them? Well, now, this is like it a year later. Now, it's not what the SEC does or the Big 10 does. They're both in not just good shape, they're both in great shape. It's what does the Pac-10, Pac-12 does, and maybe the Big 12. And then you wonder what happens with Notre Dame. But you don't, you're the Big Ten, the SEC. You don't have to make any other moves. Everybody's got like all over the, how do you go after North Carolina? What about Clemson? That Grant and Wright's deal in the ACC. Legal experts will tell you that is pretty close to ironclad. That's not that easy to get out of. And that's something you've got to, you know, I mean, there's so many elements of, you know, and that's why it's become the silly season. Clemson, Florida State, North Carolina, Duke, they're all going to the SEC. Big Ten's got to get Boston College. Boston's a big market. What about Stanford? No. Stanford? No. No, no. It's about markets and brands in combination, the branding these days. You're trying to negotiate, you know, TV deals. The most powerful people are Jimmy Pantera and Mark Silverman from ESPN and Fox, respectively. They're the most powerful people right now in collegiate sports. And then we'll see how the college football playoff plays out. But that's where we are. That's why I have refused to participate in the silly season. Now, is it interesting talk? Sure. Does it drive, you know, hey, let's see if we can get more streaming numbers. Okay? I don't play that game. Much to the suit's chagrin. Yeah. Now, we'll have Tony on today. Believe me, that'll drive. Mike DeCourcy, that'll drive. Aeneas Hawkins, that'll drive. Mark Fowler tomorrow, that'll drive. And that looks, and we're on track to get Bill Bender of Sporting News on Friday as well, okay? And Hal Steinbrenner, excuse me, Yankees are not going to talk contract with Aaron Judge during the season. It's your guy.
Yeah, we knew that already. That's not, that shouldn't even be a story. We knew that already.
It's your guy. I mean, yeah, but no, I mean, next year when he's playing for, you know, pick a team, you'll wish you negotiated with him during the season. I'm just kidding. But you won't even respond.
We'll cross that bridge if we even get to
he
it.
He had a good one. He had a good one for five last night. All right. Last offer they made.
Get the lingerie on the deck. Call the janitor.
He had a good, I'm sorry, the last offer the Yankees made to him was 7 years, $30.5 million a season.
Correct.
That was the last offer they made. Then the other story, of course, is your guy, Baker Mayfield, going to the Eagles in exchange for Jalen Hurts. No, I'm just kidding.
Oh, my almighty!
Baker Mayfield was sent to the Carolina Panthers today. In exchange for a conditional draft pick. So, there you go. Those are the big stories today. And Nadal won in five sets to get to the Wimbledon semifinals. And he will, Curious will be the one that he'll face. And they don't like each other. It's kind of looking at Lawrence and the suit in the same room. Same thing. Bill Bender is going to join us on Friday, by the way. That has been confirmed. Okay? From Sporting News to talk about all this. If that's okay with you, I don't want to cross into your territory here.
It's fine with me.
So what are you going to do next week?
Got a couple things up my sleeve.
Do you really?
I do.
Yeah, that's great.
Got plenty of good material to look back on as you enjoy a week off.
It's mostly going to be about the Yankees, isn't it? All right, so Couldn't even beat the Pirates. All right.
I'll throw in Pirate fans a bone. That's all.
I thought Tyone was very impressive in his return. All right.
I wasn't surprised one bit. Mr. Mediocrity continues.
Oh, you're just every time there's a problem, you panic.
He has been. He's always been a mediocre pitcher. Sure, this is his best season of his mediocrity, but he's still mediocre. The guy is inconsistent.
Yeah, but you got a mediocre quarterback and you love him.
Because he makes some splash plays every once in a while. Tyone, you get the same thing.
Just like the Giants. I thought in the Giants game, I thought your guy looked good.
All right, well, that was a downslope. Tyone's just like, he's a guy like you're walking on a tightrope and you're just waiting for him to fall. And he fell again last night.
I thought Judge's 1-for-5 last night was solid.
FOULED, that spells fouled up.
I said, oh my goodness, it's not good when the farm team beats the big club.
we'll throw them a bone. Have some fun. This is their World Series this week.
They drew 37,000 last night. They were 97% of capacity.
And 97% were all in pinstripes.
Well, no, believe me, the mere fact that the Yankees were there, brought them out in droves. Again, this goes. We've been talking about the Big Ten thing. Okay, now you understand what I'm talking about with branding. What brands mean?
Yeah.
Okay, the Yankee brand, and obviously the Yankees are playing great this year, but they never go to. They rarely, if ever, go to Pittsburgh. Rare. What has it been, 4 years? 5 years?
4 years. 2017. Yeah.
4 years. So I guess I got it right. And it makes a big difference. People are like, oh, my goodness. That's why they started interleague play, so something like this can happen. And for Pittsburgh, and they'll draw 37,000 again tonight. All right, we'll take a break. Come back, Aeneas Hawkins, next half hour. Great to have you with us today as we continue on News Radio 1070 WKOK.
When car repairs get difficult.
Well, I just don't know.
Me neither.
We get good. Sunbury Motors. More than quality new and used cars, Sunbury Motors specializes in complicated auto repair diagnosis. They can handle intricate repairs and even complete auto body with service open Monday through Friday, 7 till 4. And Sunbury Motors has made simple repairs easy. Maintaining your vehicle is necessary. Finding the time to do it is difficult. Welcome to Sunbury Motors Quick Lane. Open 7 till 4, Monday through Friday. Just walk in or call ahead. Relax in their remodeled waiting room with Wi-Fi, beverages, and snacks. Will Sunbury Motors factory trained techs take care of your oil change, tire alignments, brakes, and inspections. Quick Lane, 6:30 to 6, Monday through Friday, Saturday, 6:30 till 2. Sunbury Motors, Ford and Hyundai, North 4th Street, Sunbury. And Sunbury Motors Kia, routes 11 and 15 in Hummel's Wharf. We take the out of auto repair.
Taking your calls at 800-795-9565. This is the Steve Jones Show on News Radio 1070 WKOK. Now, from the Sunbury Motors Studio, here's Steve Jones.
Today's show brought to you by Sunbury Motors, 4th Street in Sunbury. Sunbury Motors Kia, routes 11 and 15, Hummel's Wharf, online at sunburymotors.com. Ford, Kia, Hyundai, the best in new inventory with great warranties. Great pre-owned inventory with the all-important Sunbury Motors guarantee. And a service department that makes it one-stop vehicle shopping. Routine work, oil changes, inspections, diagnostics, they handle it all at Sunbury Motors, 4th Street in Sunbury. Sunbury Motors Kia, routes 11 and 15, Hummel's Wharf, and online at sunburymotors.com. And one quick point about Notre Dame. Notre Dame's TV deal with NBC, I think there is a perception that Notre Dame's TV deal, which they don't have to share, I mean, it's their money, is this gigantic number. That, of course, they would never make a move. They choose not to make a move for their own reasons, but the TV deal, which is very good, and it's very good, okay? Is not what you think it is. The Big Ten is getting in the neighborhood of about $54 million between everything right now. Notre Dame's TV deal with NBC okay. is something that a lot of people think that is worth now. Now they when they make other TV appearances, by the way, they get additional money for that. Their deal with NBC runs through the 2025. Now, do you know what they get from that TV deal? What do you think? Here, I'll let you guess, Matt. What do you think? Just on the NBC part.
I thought it was like 20 to 25 mil.
15.
Oh. Lower than that. Okay.
Everyone thinks it's this astronomical number. They get $15 million a year from NBC in the current deal. It should be pointed out that Notre Dame, of course, that's just for the home games that they have that are on NBC. Any game that's on ESPN, ABC, whatever it may be, they obviously get a payout for that as well. But that's... Right, that's it's not the astronomical number people think it is. And NBC has money to play with. We're going to get to Aeneas here in a moment. NBC has money to play with. You know why? Because they're no longer doing the NHL, which was $100 million a year. So they've got money to bid with the Big Ten. That's why they can do it. And again, their deal with Notre Dame, which still has four seasons to run, $1 million a year. So they're not overspending at NBC. They've got $100 million to play with per year. Not over life. Per year, they have $100 million to play with if they want to do a primetime Big Ten game. This is what this is all about. Okay, but it's $15 million a year. So when you want to talk to your friends about the TV part of it, again, that's only the NBC part. So that's Notre Dame's, seven home games? They play six, seven home games a year. They get the $15 million. Then the other ones, they obviously get money for that, too. All right, let's hear in the Sunbury Motor. Yes, Hawkins. Great to have the Hawk in the building.
Great to have you here, Hawk.
Oh, man. Thank you guys for having me again, man.
This is an interesting time of the year. Take us back. You know, obviously, the last 2 years, there's no Live for Life. But at this time of the year, July, training camp is 3.5 weeks away. What are players doing right now? And how important is it? Is there a fine line between keep working, but also taper in such a way where I'm ready to go for camp?
Yeah, so you know the summertime is a grind by nature, as you may imagine, especially with Chuck Losey at the helm now. Him and his mustache, they're really getting after things. While most people are spending their July 4th, you know, eating hot dogs with their families, those guys are going after it. Conditioning, a lot of individual drills, player-led type of stuff. But like you said, preparing for camp, And there is a fine line. There is. And the coaches kind of have implemented a program in which, you know, you still work hard, but when it comes time to get your legs ready to play football, they do a good job with that. So definitely a fine line that you got to kind of teeter there.
Yeah, it's also a fine line in camp itself. Same thing. With about 10 days to go, is it a lot of it about recapturing legs while still staying at least mentally sharp?
Yeah, so, you know, we take great pride. It's a big adjustment at the college level, actually. Once you get to that point where you're trying to make it more mental, trying to save your legs, you know, things like walkthroughs, things like, you know, maybe shorts and T-shirts out of practice to kind of take some of the stress off of the physical portion of it. Mm-hmm. But, you know, you have to be careful, especially as a young player, to not think of it as a day off, right? You know, you're still going out there and focusing on the mental execution, different assignments you may have, things like that.
What did it take for you, for example, to grasp, okay, mental reps are important, I better take it that way? Because everybody, you know, because, like you say, a young player would go, ah, okay, good.
Yep. It depends. It's interesting because, you know, every player doesn't come in the same place.
Right.
So for a guy like me, I was not nearly physically ready to compete at this level. So even the days where they were mental, for me, I took it as an opportunity to catch up. Okay, mm-hmm. These guys are better than me physically, but if I really lock in on the playbook now, then maybe it'll pay off in the future. And other guys come in, and typically the young guys you see struggling to, you know, understand, hey, the mental aspect is just as important, are the guys who have been able to fly by just being better athletes than everybody. So you definitely see that with young guys a lot.
So let's get to one of those young guys. A guy that performed during the course of the winter workout and in the spring and impressed a lot of people was Zane Durant.
Yeah.
When you watched him at that position, since you know that position so well, what impressed you for a young player?
Yeah, the number one thing, obviously all kinds of physical talents. I think we talked about it last time I was here. He reminds me a lot of Kevin Givens.
Yeah.
In terms of athleticism,
yes,
and raw strength, and his frame really is similar too. But beyond that, his mentality was light years ahead of what you typically see freshmen coming in with. He was very focused, a humble kid, eager to learn, and all of those skills really to me are going to be what translate initially and what really allow him to, you know, crack that lineup and see some good time before his physical attributes are able to take over.
All right, so, and then there's a guy that people saw at the end of last year, mm-hmm, Jordan Vanderbilt.
Mm-hmm.
And by the way, impressed a lot of people at Lift for Life.
Yeah.
What makes now Vanderbilt is moving up. People don't realize he's from South Africa.
Yep.
All right, so he didn't exactly grow up playing football. What do you see in him?
Yeah, he is a high, high motor guy, and that is what makes him so special. He is really fast, really strong, good D tackle, but the thing that really sets him apart when you cut his film on, when you watch him in games, is the way he runs sideline to sideline every play. Rob Windsor, I keep referencing old D tackles, but Rob Windsor was another guy who flashed a lot of that same type of motor. And that's really the thing that makes Jordan stand apart, aside from the things you see at Lift for Life with his raw strength, his athleticism. But that motor is going to carry him in this game for a long time.
Yeah, there was a point last year, he was actually on the scout team, and James made the point, hey, you know what, more we look at Jordan Vanderbilt. He told the whole team this,
yeah,
right? He said, the more you look at him, the more you get the idea he's going to move over and start playing. What does that tell everybody about the coaching staff, that it's not just looking at the guys that are in the first two units, they're looking at everybody?
Yeah, I mean, it's important because, you know, with a big roster, with only so many guys who can play on Saturdays, you want to know as you come into that building as a player that you are going to have the opportunity to showcase that you are able to play on Saturdays. The coaches are always looking. Coach Franklin always says everything's evaluated.
Mm-hmm.
And it can sound like rhetoric, but Jordan Vandenberg is a prime example of that. He was on the D squad. He's a freshman. And pretty quickly, people notice, hey, this kid's special. And he earned an opportunity to go play at the end of last year.
Let's talk about some of the guys you competed with on the offensive line.
Yep.
Because you had to go head-to-head with those guys along the way every day.
Mm-hmm.
Give me a couple names that stand out to you that bear watching in camp for all of us.
Yeah. Number one, I'm going to throw them out there, Juice Scruggs.
Yeah.
Hands down, the hardest interior offensive lineman I ever played against. Tough kid, smart, athletic. You're going to see him take a huge step forward this year. Had a good year last year. Other guys to know, Salim Wormley, who we were missing last year. You know, before he got hurt, was really, really taking huge strides. Great punch on him, great interior guard. But there are a lot of guys on that offensive line. Olu Fashanu, Landon Tangwall, Nick Dawkins has made huge strides. That looks to be a group that's widely improved, a lot of veteran presence there.
I think a lot of people realize Salim Wormley had won the left guard spot.
Yeah, it was his.
And I say that with all due respect to Eric Wilson.
Yep.
Okay,
yep.
And Eric did a good job. But Salim won that.
Yeah.
And that's a tough blow for an offensive line when you lose a guy, because cohesion is so important, isn't it?
Absolutely.
All right. So, I mean, Juice Scruggs has gone through a lot to get to this point. What did it take for him to actually rebuild his body after the accident to get him to the point where now he is a mountain of a man?
Yeah. I mean, you people always want to talk about the physical aspects. And, of course, that's a part of it, rehabbing from injury and the situation he found himself in. And he did that. But in order to get there, to overcome such a big injury, I keep talking about the mental aspect. That is the most important thing,
yeah.
To show up and go to rehab every morning, every afternoon. When things don't necessarily look like they're going to work out, Juice was a guy who never lost his confidence and his belief that he was going to be a special player regardless of the circumstances that were thrown his way. And that's why he's thriving now.
All right. How important are teammates in a journey?
Oh, man.
When you take, because everybody, now obviously I see more than everybody. I understand that. So that's probably why a lot of these questions I can ask. But people see Saturdays.
Mm-hmm.
They don't see Sunday through Friday. Not every day is a great day. How important are teammates in getting you through not every day is a great day?
I think it's the most important thing. Just in my experience, you know, having guys like P.J. Mustipher and Odafe Owe and Nick Tarburtons, you know, because like you said, every day is not a great day. It's a grind. A lot of times, if you look at the whole mountain that you have to climb, it can be discouraging. And situations are not always the best for each player. There are a lot of guys to please on the team, and everybody wants to play. So really having your teammates to lean on when things get hard, you know, it keeps you going. It keeps you going. It motivates you. You see guys going through similar things that you're going through, and they're fighting through it too. And that brotherhood, that camaraderie, to me, is the most important aspect of a team. And when you see guys who may not look like they have a great opportunity to play, and they're still grinding the same way that the starters and the captains are grinding, that is how you tell when a team is getting ready to have a special season.
And that's something I've said. I think a lot of people have made this observation, so what I'm saying is not going to be unusual. But to me, I've always felt teams were able to thrive when your hardest worker was your best player.
Yep.
And that's, you know, we saw that with, you know, Saquon's before you.
Yep.
But saw that with Saquon. Hardest worker.
Yep.
Well, if he's working like that, right, and sometimes coaches will drive the hardest player to let everybody know that, hey, I'm driving the hardest player.
Yep.
It does make a big difference. I got to ask you about Dawkins,
mm-hmm.
because Hawk and Doc, the podcast,
uh-huh.
on the way. What's made him fun? And by the way, it's one of the coolest things I've seen is here, just very subtle, how he took his dad's number.
Yep.
He's got 53 on now.
Yeah, no, Doc is, he's a great dude. You know, as a player, he's really grown up a lot. Came in, obviously, you know his family backstory. You know the gene pool he comes from. But everybody develops at different times, right? And offensive line specifically, you know, playing center, it's a mental and physical game. It's warfare in there. So it takes a lot of guys a longer period of time inside to be able to develop and play. But that kid has a big personality. The guys in that room gravitate towards him. Which is important, especially when we talk about the center position. Every single play, they're communicating all the checks.
Mm-hmm.
They got to be smart kids, which Doc is one of the most intelligent football players I ever was around. So I think he's getting ready to be special. And he's a worker, too. That's another thing. I've seen that kid, you know, when it comes time to go, I see him watching those Daryl Dawkins highlights in the morning, and I know Doc is about to put a show on in the weight room. So, you know, Doc's a good dude. That's my guy, my roommate.
Yeah. Well, interesting, too, though. It's not just center. He can play both guard spots.
Yes, he can.
Too. I mean, can he play tackle? Yeah, but he can play both guard spots. Give me the importance of versatility.
Oh, man.
On the offensive line, especially. Because I've seen over the years that, look, it'll come time, there'll be an injury.
Yep.
They want to play the five best guys, not the next guy, just the next guy up.
Yep, especially at O-line. You want to be able to put your best guy in. And versatility, especially a guy in Doc's position or a guy who has been in Doc's position, you know, when that opportunity comes up, you want to be able to be versatile so that when that opportunity comes, they're not passing over you and going to the next guy. So he's a guy, like you said, can play all three spots. Could probably play tackle. That kid is a true 6'5".
Yeah.
Long arms and athletic. So, you know, it's super important. And obviously, just from a team perspective, a guy goes down, which is typical in a physical position group like offensive line. You want to make sure that you have adequate guys who can come in and keep the ball rolling.
You should be doing this for a living.
I want to be like Mr. Jones when I grow up. Everybody, listen, I've been saying that for years.
By the way, Baker Mayfield was just traded to the Carolina Panthers.
Oh, man. Goodness gracious.
All right, for a conditional pick. I'm sure the conditional pick is they win the Super Bowl and it's a one.
Yep, of course.
But he just became a Carolina Panther. So State College's Matt Rhule.
Yep, yep.
Now has Baker Mayfield.
Go hang out with Yitor Gross Matos and the gang, man.
There you go. And Brandon Smith.
Yeah, and Brandon Smith.
D. Smith's down there,
oh,
too.
Oh, man. Yep.
Hey, he wants to do this. Right, he's already better than I am. What the heck?
No, absolutely not. No way.
Pretty close. All right. Hey, thanks so much,
Mr. Jones.
Great
thank
to
you.
Have you here.
Yes, sir.
Yes. See another. See, I couldn't get. I can't break Stoll as saying Mr. Jones. I can't break Hawk as saying Mr. Jones.
No. Right? That day will never come.
But see, but that's. I did explain yesterday when I've gone back to quote my old neighborhood. Now I don't go back there any longer, only because both my parents have passed. But same thing. I would see people, I don't know, 5-6 years ago, and go, "Hi, Mr. Thomas. Hi, Mr. Roy."
It doesn't right. It doesn't go anywhere.
It doesn't change. I still same as these
guys. If my mom turned on the radio and heard me calling you anything other than Mr. Jones, I'd have to answer for that when I got off. So that won't happen.
That I know. That I know from your mom. Aeneas Hawkins. If I could just get the suit to call me Mr. Jones.
Oh, my almighty!
I'd like to see that, too.
Actually, I'd like to actually get him just to say my name, because I don't think he knows it. All right, we'll come back with more in a month. Who are these people? I mean, I'm the straw that serves the drink.
Get the lingerie on the deck. Call the janitor.
Here on News Radio 1070 WKOK.
They're deep in negotiations with those schools. There are some reports that there may be something happening by tonight. I don't know if you could move that fast, but I thought ever since Thursday when USC and UCLA went to the Big Ten that this reorganization would have to happen pretty quickly. Just because you have these media rights expansion, or media rights deals coming up, and that the Big 12 and the Pac-12 are in competition with each other right now. And really, if one or the other has the edge, look, we haven't even talked about the fact that this could severely impact the Big 12. If they don't get some of those teams, then they would be the smallest of what exists of the Power Five right now. If somehow the Pac-12 were able to expand and take Big 12 teams.
Mike DeCourcy, Sporting News, BTN, next half hour. Tony Knapp, final half hour. Matt pacing now. For the entire hour, because the Yankees won't negotiate with Aaron Judge. It's just...
I'll be pacing as we get closer to beginning of next season, the off season. Then I'll be pacing.
I'm not really that worried about it. Drives you nuts, doesn't it?
Well, of course you're not.
Hey, look, what's he going to be, 50? I'm just kidding.
A little less than that.
He's going to be 31 next year.